Thank you for joining Auto Network Reports. I'm your host, Roosevelt, and we will take you inside the auto industry like never before. I hope. We will be coming to you from Hotlanta. Two guys down there in Hotlanta that just burning up the city. We have Mr. Greg Morrison, Bumper to Bumper TV. We have Mr. Chris Lawrence, AutoAcademics.com. He's still our PhD, even though he lost his official office, but that's okay. And out of Detroit, we have Frank Washington, AboutThatCar.com. And guys, this has been a rough week for the auto industry. On the car company side, we lost probably one of the most influential CEOs in a long time, and that's Mr. Massioni. Sergio, anybody who's watched Sergio do a presentation at an auto show, he was different. He looked different. He dressed different. And he challenged the car industry. And on our side, from an auto journalist standpoint, we lost one of our great, I guess Warren was probably one of the most original automotive journalists out there on the circuit. Mr. Warren Brown passed as well. So it's been a rough week on the auto side. And I'm sure you guys, I don't know whether you've had an opportunity to personally meet Sergio. He's probably one of the few CEOs that I didn't have an opportunity to interview and place on the web. But I don't think there's been an auto industry exec that ever asked you not to buy their product. And if you guys remember when Sergio was telling everybody, don't buy the Fiat 500e because they lose $14,000 per copy. So, and I don't think that helped Fiat at all in the long run, but he was telling people not to buy the car. You just don't see that often. And with Warren, I'm sure all of us have spent some time with Warren Brown in the past. And Warren and I go way back. He kind of helped me get started in business. And he introduced me to the Black RVs Association and got me involved in covering recreational vehicles. And Warren, for a long time during the summers, one of the top RV manufacturers would give him one of these most expensive RVs, and that's how he would spend his summer vacation, driving around the country in the laps of luxury back then. So I had an opportunity to go out, get a couple of RVs myself with the help of Warren, introduced me to the RV Association, which happened to be in Reston, Virginia, where I lived at that time. As a matter of fact, it was within walking distance of where I lived. So I was able to get an RV, and Tom Joyner had an event, the Black Family Reunion, if you guys remember that, when you used to do the Black Family Reunion. I don't know if they still do it or not, but it was in Washington, D.C. I had a 35-foot RV parked on Constitution Avenue for the weekend. Unheard of. So, but that's what Warren did for me, and I've been checking out the response on Facebook. Everybody had a good opinion of Warren, and Warren didn't bite his tongue. He didn't bite his tongue. He spoke the truth, and he didn't bite his tongue, and he didn't back down from anybody. Go ahead, Greg.
I see. I've got a little further history with Warren. I go back to the mid-70s when Warren and I knew each other in Philly. He was a general assignment and a police reporter for the Inquirer. And then when I was a very young and very skinny radio reporter, I'm not young or skinny anymore. And, you know, then he left to go to the Post. And I said, oh, my gosh, he's gone big time. He'll never remember us mere mortals who, you know, would run, cover the same stories with him. And surprise, surprise, I ran into him in Detroit. Must have been 15, 20 years ago now. And I walked up to him and said, you don't remember me. He says, Greg Morrison, how the hell are you? I mean, you know, all of us are heartbroken. He's a class act. And you know, you're right about didn't bite his tongue, not only about the auto industry, but he spoke frequently and eloquently on issues of race and equality in politics. And he did not back down from anybody. And I think a big part of it is, you know, based on who he was and where he came from. He came from a very strong family in New Orleans and took no prisoners. So I will miss my friend. I will miss seeing him. But I understand, you know, this happens and he is at peace.
Yeah. Warren knew, another thing, Warren knew his stuff. You know,
he knew his stuff.
He just didn't go out there and write stories without or interview people without having some background and having his notes, his research and notes in order. So.
Big loss.
Yeah. All right. What are we going to do? Well, let's go up a little bit. We've been down now long enough for the show. Let's take it up a notch. Greg, what are you driving this week?
Well, let me tell you what I drove last week. I just got out of it.
That's what I mean. I guess I better start saying what did you drive last week? Okay.
I had the new Nissan Leaf, the SL trim level. I am really impressed with what Nissan has done with this all electric vehicle. The range is now 120 to 140 miles, no problem, as opposed to 85 miles when the car first came out.
Frank, what are you doing? Mute yourself.
You had to get no, someone running for
it. I will not.
Mute yourself.
No, I'm not doing nothing.
Yeah. Frank from New Orleans, you know, ain't gonna do nothing.
I thought Greg may have been out in there.
Frank needs to oil his chair.
Yeah. And that's not my chair. In honor of Warren Brown, I am not muting anything. I'm not backing off.
Well, be quiet.
Quit talking to me. That's all you got to do.
Go ahead, Greg.
I'm minding my own business.
Go ahead, Greg.
Well, while Frank finds his documents, the other thing I liked about this movie was the styling. It looks like the rest of the Nissan small crossover lineup, and it's really distinctive style and different from what the vehicle originally came out with. It still maintains its internal space. Drove it around town, even tried the e-pedal, which I really fell in love with. I don't know if any of you remember going to the amusement park and driving the bumper cars, the electric bumper cars. With the e-pedal, it felt something like that. So when you took your foot off the accelerator, the car would stop. And Chris will testify to this. We've had 90 degree temperatures here in Atlanta, gridlock traffic through the downtown connector. And I had to go up to the north side of town the other day. Everyone else is sweating bullets trying to, you know, get off, go somewhere. I'm just sitting there relaxed and cool as a cucumber. They have done a great job. And what I'm looking forward to see when they take the Leaf technology and put it in a bigger vehicle. That's really what will be worth watching. I was very impressed with it, shot the video. I'll try to get it posted up in the next couple of weeks.
Great. Now, Hyundai is bringing the Insight back. No, they're not bringing it back, but they're saying that the 2019 Insight is not going to be an ugly electric car. Greg, is the Leaf an ugly electric car?
No, the Leaf is not an ugly electric car anymore. It, like I say, it has lines, looks very much like the rest of the Nissan lineup. And what Honda is going to do with the Insight, it's about time. Because to be honest with you, there were days when I looked at it and thought, who planned this? And one of my knocks on it was like the roof line. If you're trying to get in the back seat, you get your head locked off in that vehicle. But if they're going to restyle it, more power to them. Let's go for it. But after this week in traffic here in Atlanta, I've come to love electric cars and what they don't do, you know, actually leave the air clean as opposed to our typical summer smog.
Great. Frank, what did you drive last week?
I had the 2018, what was it, Hyundai Accent SE. And how should you say, I was really impressed with the car. I had the SE is a basic model. I mean, there's no navigation, no satellite radio, none of that. You know, it's basically AM, FM, although it would stream. But the thing I thought really interesting that gave the car some spunk was, what am I thinking? The manual transmission. It was a 6-speed manual. And so it had unexpectedly some pep. You know, you see a car that small, it's just a subcompact, and you think it's slow. And it wasn't. It's not like it was burning rubber or anything. But, it had a little spunk. It had a 1.6 liter four-cylinder engine that made 130 horsepower and I think 119 pound feet of torque. I got into the back seats, and I think anybody except for a true blue 6-footer could fit back there in relative comfort, you know, because I had some head space. And I was just really impressed. And for, you know, what the car, it cost $16,000, you know, and $5 if you want the exact price. Yeah. It was a nice car. You know, I really couldn't find anything to really, how should you say, quibble about.
Great. Chris.
All right, so I'm actually going to share what I have this week, because I've had it all week, and I just finished my putting together a review of the vehicle. It's the 2019 Hyundai Veloster Turbo Ultimate. I remember you guys talking about that a number of weeks or even a couple months ago when they did the launch on it. I unfortunately wasn't on that launch, but I did get one this week to enjoy. And it really is a nice, small, sporty hatchback vehicle. I've got to say, Civic needs to be careful, because there are many more sporty hatches hitting the market now, and legitimate sporty hatches, not just, you know, these cars with red S badging, but actual vehicles that drive well, have good powertrains. This one has a 1.6 liter turbo, 4-cylinder engine, makes 201 horsepower, 195, I believe, pound-feet of torque, 0 to 60s in the low 6s. It's got a dual-clutch transmission. I have to admit, when I went out to see the car when it was first delivered, I was like, okay, first thing I was looking for was the stick shift. I was hoping that it was a manual transmission, and it wasn't. But then once I took it out for the first drive, I was like, oh, okay, I'm actually not as disappointed as I thought I was going to be. The fact that it doesn't have a manual transmission. The dual clutch transmission is quick, it's smooth. It really is a nice vehicle. Its fuel economy is 28 miles to the gallon in the city, 34 on the highway, with an average of 30, which is right in there with the best of them. And the total price, $29,160. So again, this is the fully loaded Veloster. It's got all of the bells and whistles, the safety tech, everything else, and you're still getting in for under 30 grand. And it's a good car.
Sounds like it. Sounds like it's the one that I'm going to be getting here pretty soon. So. Let me see if I can pull up what am I doing this week, or what am I in? This happens to be the 2018 Volkswagen Passat GT V6. That's my intro. That's not the Passat, as most of you know. Has a 3.6 liter V6, 280 horsepower, 258 pound feet of torque, 6-speed DSG automatic transmission with Tiptronic. Exterior color is a metallic gray with a black roof, which is just a good-looking automobile with that, like a two-tone, I guess you would call it. The interior is a black moon rock leatherette. 19 miles per gallon city, 28 highway, 22 combined, has an MSRP of $29,995. That's $29,995. Was the MSRP for this particular model. The first thing that impressed me about this car from the inside is there is so much rear seat leg room and head room that it is unbelievable. I mean, I had to get out and say, wait a minute, is this a long wheelbase? They didn't say anything about it being a long wheelbase, but this car, the room in the rear seat. And I had the opportunity to take a couple of friends of mine who were up from Atlanta for a family reunion, and they happened to get in, and they were totally impressed about the leg room. They said, what is this? What kind of car is this? It has this much leg room in it. Enormous amount of leg room. Extremely quiet vehicle. Huge trunk. It's responsive. The suspension and handling is just spot on. The handling is spot on. The ride comfort is great. The suspension seems to just absorb the bumps. And I like to run it over some rough roads. Try to find some railroad tracks, but I have to go downtown in Charlotte to find railroad tracks. So it's a little hard for me to run it across the railroad track. Our roads are pretty good. It's even hard to find a lot of potholes to take this thing over. But I tried to find some of the roughest roads I could. And it rides extremely well. It handles well. And it looks good. What do you guys think?
Well, you know, I got a chance to get some seat time in the four-cylinder version of the Passat. And I agree with you about the interior. The interior is very well done. Suspension is spot on. But, you know, one thing I like really about the Passat more than anything?
What's
sight that? Lines. The old, when you put, you know, back of the car up and you're looking out the rear view window or looking at a corner, the vehicle's coming to that right rear window. Great sight lines in this vehicle. So I think Volkswagen has finally gotten the Passat right.
I like it. I was waiting to chime in, but
that pregnant pause.
But I like it. I've always appreciated the opportunities that I get to review the Volkswagen cars, and the Passat is a nice looking car, nicely styled. They drive well. You still hear some of the stuff, you know, the reliability, all that kind of stuff. That stuff still trails in now and then. But now with Volkswagen's current warranty that they're offering as well, even that kind of puts all that gibberish to the side and allows you to say, okay, you know what? Let's give this car a try because it really is they're very nice driving cars and they look great.
Yeah, you know, it's I guess it depends on what age group you're talking to when you talk about reliability on some cars, because I know some people, when I mention Audi, they go back to the Audi 5000.
Exactly. I mean, exactly. You're like, really?
Yeah,
right. Really?
Can you find one that's running?
Yeah.
Exactly.
You know, I look at him and say, well, do you remember when you had hair?
Hey, I still have hair.
Some people just can't let it go.
Exactly.
And it's amazing how many people don't understand the light speed of technology these days. I mean, cars are now designed on computer systems from designers literally and engineers literally sitting in different parts of the world operating on the same design and suspension in real time. Some manufacturers still do the big clay models. I'm sure a lot of them do. But before you even get to the clay, the car is... it's built on a computer. And there are a lot of things that they can test on the computer. They can test, like Greg was talking about, the sight lines. They can test all that stuff. They can test the ride and handling. They can test the suspension. They can test the brakes because all these systems now are operated by software. So, I mean, they can tweak the software to see what a car is going to do. And if you're not following the industry, and most people don't look at cars unless they're close to being in the market to buy one, there's so many things that you miss as to the light speed of how these cars are getting better and better. And we always say it's hard to find a bad car in the marketplace. And if you're out there now looking for a car, first, you may as well, most people don't want to do it, but you got to start with your pocketbook. If you don't start with your pocketbook, you're going to be very, very upset because you want to look at a $50,000 car and you only have a $27,000 pocketbook. Forget it.
Champagne taste and Pepsi pocketbook.
Thank you. But you can find some very good cars in the $27,000 price range. Like Frank was talking about, what, the Accent in the night, the $16,000 price range. Yeah.
And it was a great car.
Right.
It really was. With any, go ahead.
But most people want to look at the name brand. If it's not one of the so-called luxury name brands, it's not a good car, which is a big mistake.
Yeah,
ahead,
I mean,
Frank, I'm sorry.
Anytime, you know, a friend or a colleague, not so much a colleague, but, you know, a friend or whatever asks me, you know, what kind of car should they get or what's the best, you know, or I'm looking for a car, blah, blah, blah. The first thing out of my mouth is how much money you want to spend. Yeah, that's the first thing, what you want to spend.
Yeah, it used to be, what's your family size? Is it just for you? Yeah. Is it just for your family? That's not even the second or third question that I ask him. The first one is like, Frank, what's your pocketbook like?
Because, you know, along those lines, I remember a friend of mine, for whatever reason, she got into this space where she wanted to buy an Audi.
Audi, so, for those who don't live in Detroit.
Right. Ahead, she wanted to buy an Audi. I say Audi, some people say Audi, whatever the case may be. And so I took her to look at them. And when she started twisting the money she had coming in, she was looking at used Audis. Okay. And we're talking $35,000-$40,000. And she started twisting the price of the car in terms of her income. And the reality set in. But, you know, afterwards she thanked me. She said, you know, I wouldn't have never believed that unless I actually went and looked. But, you know, as you say, a lot of people, you know, don't really realize just how much these cars cost and how much the cost of a car impacts your income in terms of what you've got to pay out of pocket to drive every month.
Yeah, they don't realize how good these cars are on the cheaper level, you know? I mean, I think all of us—
Inexpensive,
exactly. Not cheap, inexpensive, yes. Or affordable, let's put it that way. You know, like all of us, when we talked about the cars that we've reviewed recently, named cars that were sub $30,000 cars, but yet, you know, at least I think Greg did also, I forget what he had said. He was first on
Adrian. Well, yeah, it was 30,000.
Yeah, so, you know, we all still, you know, we all thought that they were good cars. And, you know, they come with all the bells and whistles that pretty much you come to expect on a car, or at least you'd want on a car in 2018. But the price is still manageable. You know, you don't have to have those luxury status cars in order to get the latest and greatest features anymore.
Well, you can't wrap $27,000 pocketbook around a $50,000 car. I don't care how much you try. It's just not going to work out.
Yeah,
you know, one of the reasons that these long terms now are getting so long, it's because the base price of cars are going up. I think the average price of a car now is somewhere around $35,000. And I think the average car loan now, if you're financing this car, is if it's not 72 months, it's close to 72 months. People are now even looking at 84 months auto loan. It's getting to be where they're going to go up to longer than that eventually. And it's the people who can't afford the car that they're trying to get into that's pushing these loan rates out to where they are now.
Well, this is where the argument for subscription comes in handy. You know, if you really want to ride that luxury car, but you can't afford, you don't want to get locked into a seven to eight year contract, then you do the subscription model and call it a day.
Well,
a lot of folks are not familiar with it, but, you know, it's just something to consider.
I've looked at subscription programs, and I don't think people can. Most people aren't going to be able to afford a subscription program. I think the least expensive one that I've heard is maybe one that Volvo has, where it's close to $600 or $700 a month, maybe a little more than that. But I've always maintained or pushed the fact, if you don't want to own your car, and with a subscription service, you don't own your car. If you know what kind of miles you drive, if you're not the kind of person that dogs the car, then you should be looking at a lease. To me, the lease is still the most economical way for you to get into an automobile and get more car than you were probably looking at and still have a reasonable monthly payment. What you have to pay attention to is wear and tear. You can't dog the car. It's not your car. Don't dog the car. Mileage is going to be a problem. Don't fool yourself. If you drive 50,000 miles a year, trust me, don't get into a lease where they only allow you 18,000 a year. It's going to cost you an arm and a leg when you want to get out of that automobile. But if you are truthful to yourself, you can probably find and customize a lease package that will give you, if not the car you want, at least you'll have close to the car that you want, and you'll be more than satisfied.
You mean I can't take it off-road like Dan Neal did with the Lincoln?
No. No, you can't do that.
Darn. What did he do?
Dan Neal took a Lincoln off-road one time.
Oh, gee. No. No comment. No, but that, I saw a report on CBS News this morning on their morning show. And I think it had to do with GM, which is entering some sort of program, kind of like an Airbnb thing, where individuals can actually rent their car to somebody else.
Right.
Striking back in new terms, in terms of the cost, which constantly goes up. Because, for instance, that accident I had a rear view camera. Rear view cameras are now mandatory. They were mandatory as of May. So as all this stuff is mandated by law, basically the price of cars are going to go up.
Right.
So I think what's happening is they're searching and hunting for I'm not saying for a cure-all, if you will, or a magic potion, but different ways they can still get people in automobiles.
Well, I think as a salesperson in an auto dealership, you really have to be upfront and truthful with the customer. You have to be a legitimate automotive consultant and explain to people how financing work, explain to people how all these packages that you want to add to a car raises the cost, explain to them the total cost of driving the car over X number of years, depending upon how you're going to, you know, how long you're going to keep it. And ask legitimate questions about family size, driving habits, and all of that. And they should have a checklist. Like when we had the car buying program, every one of my consultants, and I had 27 of them, had a checklist that we developed over 3 or 4 years of talking to customers and members about the type of car that they were interested in. And every consultant had to fill out that checklist on that person before they even attempted to find a car for them. And people appreciated that. It's just like you were talking about, Frank, when you took the lady to the Audi deal. She appreciated that.
Yes.
But being a commission salesperson, I can understand the pressures that you're under. Been there, done that. But in the long run, you trust me, you will make more money because people will be referring people to you.
Yeah, I know that. Yeah. Well, actually, Frank's going to make an extra dollar as a consultant taking people to dealerships.
Well, that's
if
one
I
of the
could,
reasons.
I would.
That's one of the reasons I'm going to bring back my car buying service. I'm still working on it, guys. It's coming. It's going to be different, but it's coming. It's coming. Okay, talking about quality of cars, the Genesis, according to the J.D. Power, the 2018 appeal study, Genesis was number one. It beat out Porsche, who held that position for 13 years. Now, for those of you who aren't familiar with Genesis, Genesis is the luxury brand now of Hyundai. Remember Hyundai, folks? The people I used to talk about all the time, trying to get people in Hyundais. Years ago, they wouldn't drive one. They didn't think that Hyundai was a good car. They thought it was too cheap. Guess what? Hyundai's not a bad car. They're still reasonably priced, and now they have their luxury brand. Genesis is number one in the J.D. Power appeal. And guess when they started Genesis? What, 2 years ago? Three years ago?
3 years ago.
3 years ago, they went to number one, beat out Porsche, who held that position for 13 years. Pay attention to what we say on the show, guys and people. Sometimes we know what we're talking about.
Well, it happens by accident.
See, Frank doesn't even pay attention.
Yeah. And he's on the show.
Yeah, right. Well, last thing, Mark Wahlberg, the actor, you all may know Mark. He does a lot of action movies. He's now an auto dealer owner. He's a part owner in a Chevy store in Columbus, Ohio. Want to welcome Mark to the industry. And according to his spokesperson, he will spend a lot of time in the dealership. So it's going to be interesting to see how many people. I know a lot of people are going to go there to try and see Mark, but how many are going to actually buy automobiles and how they treat the customers?
Buy a Chevy, take a selfie.
Right. Okay, 30 minutes went real quick. Again, we want to send out condolences to the family of Sergio Marchione and our good buddy and brother from a long time, family of Warren Brown, both passed this week. And as always, folks, please buckle up. Don't drink and drive. Buckle up. Don't text and drive. And since Frank here, I have to give this to Frank. Buckle up. Don't stream and drive.
That's right.
Frank, I'm getting a t-shirt with all of that on it, man. I'm going to send you one.
Please. Large.
See you next time.
See you later.
Bye.